I've been a puppet, a pauper, a pirate, a poet, a pawn and a king. I've been up and down and over and out, and I know one thing. Each time I find myself laying flat on my face, I just pick myself up and get back in the race. That's life.
Well, welcome everybody to the special edition of the Brett and Larry Show. I'm very honored to have my co-host with me today, Larry Delrose.
Yeah, we were last night. Now we're today. We're doing these daily now.
Well, it's pretty bad because I'm seeing you more than I see my own wife now.
Yeah, no, your wife's here. Sarah's our producer.
Oh, there she is.
She's great. And there'd be no show without her, of course. But we got light subjects now, so we're not doing any of our kind of dark stuff. But these guys that we got today kind of got little dark issues, but it's about the environment. So it's going to be great. We're going to have a really great show. When I watched the stuff that they're doing, I was like really impressed. What do you think, Brett?
Well, I have to be honest with you. I have not seen any of the film yet. I've just been hearing about it through, you know, osmosis people talking about it. But you're in the, is it the fourth annual Blue Water Film Festival? Is that what it is?
Correct.
Fourth one, yeah.
Fifth annual.
Fifth.
Oh, yeah. Time's going by.
We went there last year, remember?
Right.
Nice festival. Okay, so who we want to start with?
We'll start with Lindsey.
Okay, let's start with Lindsey. We got Lindsey Haskin, and he's got a film called Relentless. Yes, so tell us about the film. Give us the tagline.
Well, the tagline is, this is about a fishery crash that took place in the Great Lakes in the 1950s and 60s that was a big mystery. Nobody knew what happened to it. There had been fishery crashes before, but nothing on this scale. And the culprits in the previous fishery crashes were overfishing by commercial fishermen and pollution from the industrial, you know, the industrialization of the area. You know, the Great Lakes became the industrial heartland of North America, and that led to a lot of pollution. A lot of rivers were dammed. That messed up fish populations as well. They couldn't get into the rivers to spawn. But all of a sudden, fish were disappearing in lakes where there wasn't a lot of population, where there wasn't a lot of dammed rivers.
Interesting, yeah.
And where our fishing wasn't all that much. So people didn't know what was going on. So the fishing community basically looked to the Canadian and federal government, Canadian and U.S. governments, to say, you got to help us out here or else we're going to lose these economies. Small towns across the whole Great Lakes region are going to go under, and a lot of family businesses are going to go under too. So the film tells a story about scientists that took up the challenge and struggled for a long time to see what they could do about this.
I like the trailer. How many Great Lakes are there? I love the Great Lakes. I like Lake Michigan. I've been on it.
No. Yeah, there's technically five Great Lakes.
So name them.
Lake Superior, Lake Michigan, Lake Huron, Lake Erie. Am I missing one? No. Lake Ontario.
So what made you pick this topic?
Well, I had made a public television film about the Great Lakes that was on television for 3 years, starting in 2010. And this was a small part of that film. That film was called Freshwater Seas, and it traced the history of the relationship between people and the Great Lakes ecosystem. So it told the story how people like Andrew Carnegie made his fortune there. John D. Rockefeller started the oil industry in the Great Lakes region. Henry Ford, you know, started mass production in the Great Lakes region. And so all that happened there because of the natural resources, because of mineral resources are there, plus all of the ability to ship those mineral resources in bulk but through the lakes. But that led to all kinds of pollution and damaging the lakes and everything. So the first half of the film is about how the Great Lakes region became the industrial heartland, you know, the great economic engine of North America. And the second half was the damage that was done and how people are trying to put it back together again so that you have, you know, the recreational opportunities for fishing and boating and those kinds of things.
You want to show the trailer so we can start, so the viewers will see that and we can get some ideas off of it? Why don't you do that, Sarah? This is Relentless, folks.
The Great Lakes have a natural organizing force for the people of the region.
The vastness of them is really hard to convey.
The Great Lakes region holds 1/5 of Earth's surface freshwater.
They're very, very important to our economy. We've got the world's largest source of clean, fresh water.
Kids grow up and they have that memory
they associate it with their time and their summers with their family on the shores of Lake Michigan or Lake Huron. And fishing is an integral part of that.
The fish that swim in the water are part of the lifeblood of the Great Lakes region.
The importance of fishing is part of that full relationship with the natural world.
Fishing is my life. I started fishing as a young kid.
You see young adults, you see women, and you see men, and they all fish. They just enjoy it. It's just a beautiful place. And a true outdoorsman, this is heaven.
Fishing in the Great Lakes is such a valuable resource.
For most of history, people simply assumed that the Great Lakes were so vast and packed with fish that there would always be plenty to catch.
It was just too easy to throw a net in the water and pull money out.
But by the 1950s, everything had changed. The fish most important to people were nearly gone.
No one could explain it, let alone fix it.
Whether you were in Lake Ontario or Lake Superior or everywhere in between, it was dire.
From small towns up to major cities, it was people's livelihoods.
We were at a loss as to what we were going to do.
Short on hope, some remarkable people tackled the mystery. Their odd discovery still menaces the Great Lakes today.
It's been described as a moonshot.
Probably the largest scale species recovery program ever.
Their battle dramatically changed how people from all walks of life connect with these freshwater seas.
We don't want to lose this. We've got to protect it.
Yeah,
we're filmmakers. We love film and we love documentary. And I have to tell you, the editing that went into that. I like the way you mix the old black and white of what it was before, the history that was there with that, because I think it adds a lot of. I mean, you did phenomenal with that. I thought.
So one fifth of the water is from those five lakes.
Yes, well, the surface freshwater.
Unbelievable.
Planet, so yeah. The only place that's similar in quantity is the Amazon River Basin. There's a lot of fresh water there as well. But the two are, you know, neck and neck. You know,
How many days did it take you to shoot this?
We shot a lot because I was commissioned to make the film. And when the organization decided they wanted to do this, there were only so many people still left who had been involved with your initial effort to fight this endangered species that came in. So the first thing we did was just go out and shoot interviews with people. We didn't have a shooting script. We didn't have an outline, okay. But we wanted to, you know, get who we could. And if you see the film, the first credit we have is in memoriam of people who are in the film that have passed away since, since we started filming.
A while, so,
yeah, we filmed over the course of 4 years.
Wow.
But we had. Well, the thing about filming in the Great Lakes region is you can only film from like May till November. Otherwise,
snow.
Yeah.
That included editing too, or 4 years including editing?
We started filming in 2017 and finished it this past summer. So,
wow.
Yeah. So
long time.
Yeah. So it was a long project. You'll see there's a lot of computer animation in it. There's all kinds of things. And one of the things I'd really like to mention as well is we were really, really fortunate to get J.K. Simmons, the Oscar-winning actor, to narrate for us.
So yeah, really? Was He's got a great voice.
Oh, I recognize.
I thought his voice sounded familiar.
Yeah, that was really great.
So, as it turns out, he's a Detroit native. He was born in Detroit. And then, interestingly enough, he moved from Detroit to Columbus, Ohio. And his dad was a music professor at Ohio State University. And so I happened to go record him the right after the Ohio State Michigan game, and Michigan had beat Ohio State, and he's a big Ohio State fan, so he wasn't happy. The Buckeyes. I went to school at the University of Michigan for 2 years, then I moved to California, became a resident, and then went to Cal Berkeley. But anyway, he was a wonderful guy, and it was a wonderful day, and one of those, you know, really just magical days of my life to work with him on this. us. And I got a chance to just sit around with him and talk with him for a couple of hours. He's just a really, really nice guy. And he has family here in San Diego.
Big deal to get him. Yeah, that's really great. It was really,
good job.
Thank you. Really good job. And so it's playing now a week from today at 2 o'clock, almost the time right now, a week from right now, at Ryford Public Library in La Jolla, right?
Correct.
Okay, so if you people are watching and you're interested, you want to see the whole film, because you can't see it anywhere else right now, right?
No, it's not streaming anywhere. No.
So let me ask you about that real quick, because we might pick up some information ourselves.
Sure.
So I want to ask you, too, you also, Alex. So after you go to film festivals, what is your ideas or hopes of streaming? What do you have in your head?
Well, I think the market will determine that. You know, certain films are going to appeal to certain exhibitors. They're going to fit in, you know, someone's program, just like film festivals. You know, certain film festivals are looking for certain types of films. So, but the key has been for us is to find representation. You know, what you learn when you go out there is I think every you know, budding filmmaker's dream is to get a film on Netflix. But if Netflix will tell you, we're not going to talk to you. No. You have to have a distributor. Exactly. You have to have an agent. And so that's one of the things that we've been working for through the festival route and all these kinds of things. And we've been successful. We've had a couple of different offers from different sales agents who want to represent us. And, we're checking on their bona fides, and we have our attorneys talking to their attorneys. And
how many documentaries have you done in your life?
Oh, I started off here in San Diego. I started in the production business in Colorado in the 80s, working with a small production company that was a wing of somebody's dad's advertising agency, but then came here and I just worked on contract production for a long time. I worked with ad agencies, public relations firms, affairs consulting firms, and I got hired to make films about public issues. I made a ton of videos for the San Diego County Water Authority. Oh. I made a lot of videos for the city of San Diego. I made a series of videos about San Clemente Island for the Navy. And so I kind of developed this ability and this specialty and a reputation for being able to work on subjects about nature.
You do editing yourself?
Yeah, I shoot. I can shoot and edit. I do the rough edits. I did the rough edit on this film, but I have an editor who I work with who does all the final polishing and all of the color corrections and making sure it fits whatever venue it's going to be exhibited and that it's fitting their specifications.
So you produce it, you shoot it, you edit it. And when you say write it, I mean, we wrote our documentary too, but when you say write it, what do you mean when you say you write it?
Well, this project was kind of an offshoot of an oral history project that was run by the Michigan Water Center, University of Michigan Water Center in Ann Arbor. And they hired a post grad to go around who spent the first year of the project just going around and finding everybody he could who was involved with the story. So he just traveled all over the place and took a little video camera and shot some preliminary interviews of things. And then based on his work, the people involved with the project, including me, we all sat down and said, okay, we think this person would be great to have in the film. This person would be great to have.
So you have like an outline or kind of like.
Well, no, we just found, where the great parts of the story.
Yeah, exactly.
It was a story I was familiar with from having including it in my previous film. And so then, we just basically took it from there and ran with it. And we came up with a shooting outline. Once we had filmed, a bunch of the interviews, we saw kind of where it was going. Then we developed a shooting outline and just, kept going from there and looking for more people to supplement what our desires were, but the direction we wanted to go. So,
what are your plans for the film after the film festival?
We're in a bunch of more film festivals. So like Alex is headed out of here to film festivals. We're in, I'm headed out on April 1st to the Midwest where we're doing 6 screenings. We're in 2 film festivals there. Oh. And then we have some organizations back there that we're supporting by letting the film be exhibited at different places. One is the Traverse City International Affairs Forum. And so we're in the Detroit, it's called the Freep Film Festival. It's put on by the Detroit Free Press newspaper.
Right.
We're going to be screened there April 13th and 14th. We're in the Central Michigan Film Festival, which is we're being screened on April 3rd there. But then we're doing something in Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan. We're doing something in Manistee, Michigan.
Right.
And eventually we're in the Green Bay Film Festival as well. So we're doing a bunch of different film festivals and things right now. Having a blast.
So you said you got commissioned. Who commissioned you to do?
There's an organization called the Great Lakes Fishery Commission, and that was formed in the 1950s. It's actually part of the story. They were formed in like 1955 through an international agreement between the Canadian and U.S. federal governments to form this agency to go after this invasive species. It was formed to take this on and save fisheries. And so it's called the Great Lakes Fishery Commission. It's still in existence and it's still doing the same thing, fighting this invasive species. It's its main job. So,
okay. And these are the lampreys.
Yeah. The sea
lamprey. They have the crazy like suction cup teeth.
Right. If you see the logo on our poster, that's that behind the title is
they're some of the creepiest looking creatures. Yeah.
This is our second guest, folks, yeah. Alex Rivest. Yeah. And we're going to talk about his film now. He is the producer, director, and writer and everything of Canary. So tell us about the tagline and Canary, and then we'll go through that.
Canary is the story of this guy is known as the real life Indiana Jones, whose name is Lonnie Thompson. He is a professor at Ohio State University. So we did a lot of filming there to bring it back to Columbus. And this is a story of a guy who grew up in poverty in coal mining country, West Virginia, destined to be in the coal mines. And his mom forced him to get an education and just said, you need to read, you need to keep working, you need to get away out of here. And he ended up having an opportunity to go to school for coal geology, went to Antarctica and fell in love with ice.
Oh.
And people were drilling ice cores in Antarctica and Greenland. I don't know if you know what ice cores are, but basically you go to a glacier and you drill vertically into the glacier and you pull back an ice, like a cylinder of ice. And contained in that ice from top to bottom is a timeline. So there's the most recent years at the top, the furthest year back is at the bottom, right?
And the timeline that he can read.
The timeline that he can read. And so people were doing this in Antarctica and Greenland, and he was having trouble finding a spot for him there. And he saw all this ice in the middle of the planet, tropical glaciers. And he said, well, why is no one doing this? And he was told, it's too high for humans and the technology doesn't exist. And plus it's in the tropics. Ice is not going to be contain a record in the tropics. He found a way to drill ice cores, bring them back through the tropics to tell us a unique history of the world. And because he was up in the mountains for so long, not only has he spent more time above 18,000 feet than any person on the planet over 4 years of his life, but he saw the changing planet before other people did. So he was at this glacier for 15 years. One day he crossed over a ridge, and where there used to be a glacier, there was a lake at 18,000 feet. And so he started saying, this is not the way it's supposed to be, and started ringing the alarm bells about what's changing. And here's the data, and went testifying in front of Congress. And we can get into some of the nuances of the story.
Did you go with him?
I did.
How many times?
Once we filmed with him up at 18,700 feet. We were there for 3 weeks. I can talk about the training we had to go through to be able to film up there. This was in central Peru, and the glacier and largest tropical glacier on the planet. We spent 3 weeks up there filming.
It's got to be hard to get there.
It was hard to get there, right? Yeah, carrying around film equipment at 18,000 feet is no easy task.
Did you take a train to get there?
We flew to Cusco, took a car to the end of the road, hopped on our feet and horses, and went another 2 days. Oh. Ended up camping at 17,000 feet for 3 weeks.
But he had been up there before. He knew the drill.
I mean, he.
So is the film all of what you shot during the time you were there only, or is some of his and some of yours?
It's all the above. So we filmed with him there. We filmed with him at his lab in Ohio. We filmed at his hometown in West Virginia. We filmed at some award ceremonies with him, went to China with him to film. And then we have 40 years of video that he took from around the planet that we've incorporated.
Yeah, let's show this one. Okay, the audience, let's see this one.
In the old days, you took a canary into the mine. If it dies, then it's time for you to flee the mine.
My first encounter with Lonnie, it was like I was meeting a real-life Indiana Jones.
Lonnie was a visionary. He saw our global climate history captured in these glaciers.
Lonnie was going where no scientist had gone before. It seemed to be impossible.
It's too high for human beings.
It's dangerous.
There's no way you're going to drill in this remote part of the world. You're wasting your time. Science can only advance when you do things other people think can't be done.
He was on a mission to find his place in this world.
I had no idea what I was getting into.
I had never climbed a mountain. I had no idea what it would take.
This was a huge departure from usual.
There was something wrong.
My doctor said, you have one option and one option only, and that is to have a heart transplant.
You just keep going.
He was in denial.
I remember watching him struggle to breathe, thinking to myself, then you're not going to survive this.
Having gone through these near-death experiences, my message was to help bring together the world.
This glacier started disappearing before Lonnie's eyes.
He thought he could change something.
If he doesn't do it, nobody would.
Lonnie didn't come to climate change. Climate change came to him.
If humans can create it, humans can solve it. I don't believe there's anything that we cannot achieve.
It's a film about, a little background on me is I used to be a scientist. I did a PhD in neuroscience at MIT. I did a postdoc. I've been involved with science my whole life. And I always felt like science programming felt a bit more like homework than anything. I always wanted to like it more than I did. And so I quit science to try to change the way scientists are seen on the big screen. And when I talked to Lonnie the first time, I was on a Skype with my partner, my directing partner, Danny O'Malley. We talked with Lonnie within 5 minutes, he had
a video.
In 40 minutes, we were both crying. And by the end of the Skype, I just turned to my partner, Danny, and I said, if there's one story we ever tell, it has to be this one.
That's a good story.
And
the passion comes across.
I mean, it is a story about perseverance. It's a story about purpose. It's a story about finding who you are in this world. It's a story that I think not only applies to scientists, but all of us. Like, we're all looking for purpose. We're all looking for something that we wake up and need to do. And
how long is the film, Canary?
It's 104 minutes.
How long is yours?
Mine's 91.
Okay.
But it's, there's an interesting thing when you're trying to teach science. When you talk about things like climate change, there's a million movies about climate change, right? And most of it's kind of disaster porn, right? And it's like, look at all this bad stuff that's going to happen to us.
Disaster porn.
But the thing is that there's, if you look at this, how to teach science from an educational standpoint, there's a whole line of educational psychology that says, if you teach kids facts, like one group of kids facts, you teach another group of kids the same facts, but you teach the struggle scientists went through to get those facts. These kids learn the facts better. The kids who learn the struggles are engaged more broadly. They understand scientific concepts more. So what we do is find stories about the human journey of struggle to be able to relate the facts. Right. And so that's the brand of science storytelling that I'm after. And this is my first film.
First film.
Yeah.
Right. And so how long to make?
We started filming in 2018. We met Lonnie in 2017. He wasn't going to the glacier until 2018. He called us, said, yeah, you guys still filming? You want to go? We had no money. We said, yes, absolutely. And we just made it happen.
So you're a scientist.
Yeah.
You're all about research.
Yep.
While making the movie, I mean, we made a movie and we understand things happen you don't expect.
Yep.
Was there anything that you learned that you weren't aware of that really blew your mind or surprised you?
So when you talk about climate change, when I first saw Inconvenient Truth back in 2020, Al Gore's Inconvenient Truth, you know, that was the first time I was exposed to kind of the facts behind climate change. And as a scientist, I went and I kind of looked at all the equations. Okay, if all the glaciers melt, what is sea level rise? I kind of did all the math and I've known it my whole life. And I always just kind of voted the way, you know, someone believes in it, someone doesn't believe in it. I vote for the person who believes in it. That was kind of the end of my climate activism. When I went with Lonnie to Peru, we went to Cusco. And in Cusco, it's 500,000 people. They all get their power from water that comes off the glacier. Okay, so that the city is powered by the glacier. Then we went up the river to the glacier, and you see this bread basket. Millions of people supported by llamas, alpacas, you know, food sources, 2.5 million people. Then we get up to the glacier, the largest tropical glacier on the planet. And I asked Lonnie, when is this going to melt by? And he said, by the time your daughter is your age, this is gone.
So what will it take for people to become like that?
Good question. I think the hard answer is that we will be forced to, right?
That's what I thought.
When sea level starts rising, we're here in Coronado. I don't know how much Coronado is going to be left, right? I mean, if you look at the projections of sea level rise in Coronado, it's going to be a different place in 50 years. So when the ocean starts lapping at your door, you're going to start thinking differently. The other thing that I truly believe in is the power of storytelling. I believe
that both of us there love storytelling.
These stories have power to be able to say, I never thought about it this way. And that becomes part of you, right?
One of the things I'd like to say is that what I really like about Alex's film and what I try to do with my film is that, with these environmental film festivals that we go to, this is an ocean film festival. These tend to draw the same people. If you're wanting to make the world a better place, you have to have stories that get beyond what are going to just attract the same people.
True.
The people that I'm going to a lot of film festivals,
and the people who go to film festivals tend to be progressive. They tend to be educated. And especially if you're going to have a film festival that has the word nature or environment in it, you're going to turn off a large segment of the population. So one of the things that I try to do with my film was, this is about fishing. Fishing is something that people across the political spectrum care about and love. And one of the unique things about the Great Lakes is that the political representatives there, the congressional delegations all support Great Lakes restoration, Great Lakes, anything to protect the Great Lakes and keep fish in them and all those kinds of things. So that to me is a way where, by stressing those aspects of the story that peel across those philosophical and political lines, that's how you get a bigger audience for these kinds of films. And what Alex is doing is, he's got a film about a human, about anybody who wants to, persevere or overcome some kind of difficulty or something like that. It's hard to imagine a more moving story than this one for anybody, no matter what they may be dealing with. People on the far right get cancer. People on the far right get heart transplants, yep. And here's a guy who's doing amazing things from there. So if we can
get these kinds of stories,
I'm agreeing with everything that Alex saying. We have to tell stories that reach across out beyond the normal audience for these kinds of films and get the word out
there. And I think too, when you're talking about small town economies, right? I mean, this is what we all talk about is kind of the beating heart of America, right? And this is something that is, that there is a universality in that we, as much as so many of us live in big cities, we all want to have preserve, the ability of that small town feel, right? That thing we grew up with.
Yeah. So people want to still be able to, go catch fish, and
eat fish,
and get on a boat and not have it stink wherever they go, and all that kind of thing.
How did you pick your title, Canary?
His Canary. I'm Relentless.
Okay. How'd you pick your title, Relentless?
It applies to both parties. This organism, it's a sea lamprey. It came in from the Atlantic Ocean into the Great Lakes, made its way up the St. Lawrence Seaway.
It's a thing with the lips.
Yeah. It's got a big suction cup with all kinds of teeth on it. So it is relentless, and it just kept going all the way up into the Lake Superior and then up to all the tributary streams. It's what's called an anadromous. It spawns in streams, and so it's just relentless in terms of what it does.
And yours could have been relentless because this guy was relentless, really. But how did you pick Canary?
Well, let me finish. The other side of it is the scientist who looked for a way to deal with this thing and save fisheries and save small town economies and save fishing in the Great Lakes. They were equally as relentless, tenacious, persistent. It took years and years and years for them to find what is considered a needle in a haystack. They had no idea that they would ever come up with something. And a lot of people were ready to stop, the congressional delegations and the Parliament of Canada was ready to stop funding their efforts, but they just kept at it. And so here we are.
Love it. Canary is, I think at the beginning of the trailer, there's this whole story of guys who would go into the coal mines, right? They would carry a cage with a canary in it. Canary in the coal mine. And then, the canary, if it falls over or gets sick first, the air is bad. You should leave. It's the early warning system. So the glaciers are our early warning system for what's happening on the planet, because ice is ice. When you get above 32 degrees, it melts, right? It's literally the first thing that starts changing. And so as the temperature warms on the planet, ice is the first responder. So you see these major changes happening. Also, Lonnie is a canary in his own right. I mean, he's speaking for the glaciers. It is about the early warning systems we have and whether or not we listen to these things, right? When the canary dies next to us in the coal mine, are we just sitting in the coal mine going to continue drilling, or are we going to get out of there? And it holds a mirror up to us.
So a lot of this, I think, you're the scientist here, of course. We just have a wide range of population. We have more population on the Earth right now than we've ever had.
Yep.
So even if we did get rid of using fossil fuels, it takes a lot of money to make things that require batteries. Batteries require heavy machinery, and there's no machinery that can make that can do the drilling there's nothing that's electric that could do that, is there?
I mean, it's complicated, right? To do anything on scale is going to have environmental consequences, right? It's a question of what are the long-term consequences of the decisions, right? So most of the mining happens in places that are very politically unstable. There is, there's people being taken advantage of,
sure.
and East Congo, which I've been to in parts of South America, it's really toxic. That being said, this is that classic problem of, the train's going one way and, there's people who will die if it goes this way. And then there's more people die if it goes that way. And you have a choice of which lever to pull. Welcome to humanity.
I think,
interesting.
As things push forward, we're going to have to choose from some unattractive options. One of them that is being talked about right now is maybe looking to nuclear power again, looking at nuclear reactors as being a clean source of power.
I heard that.
There's a lot of risks that are involved with that. But if we want to have all these people on the planet and we want to live the lifestyle that we're living, we want to consume at the rate that we're consuming, and we want to be warm in our houses, and we want to have all these cool electronic things, and we're going to have AI, and we're going to have all these, computers doing all kinds of crazy stuff. We need a lot of power. And so are we willing to make these kinds of decisions and make these kinds of trade-offs? Where's the cost-benefit analysis here, and what kind of risks as a society are we willing to assume?
So, what was the other one?
Which other?
Besides nuclear.
Oh, well, more, we can dam more rivers, we can do more hydropower, we can do all those kinds of things, but that's going to impact fish, that's going to impact, all kinds of societal things. That's going to impact clean water. There's, we can do more geothermal. There's also tidal options for generating power. We already have wind power that's going up off of our coast. Is that something that we want to have off of Martha's Vineyard or off of San Diego? Would we like to have a whole just line of wind power generators off the coast of San Diego? Is that something that we want to have here? These are the kinds of decisions we're going to have to consider if we want to, lessen our dependence on fossil fuel and maintain, the energy consumption that we've grown accustomed to. So,
maybe a little of each one.
I mean, we just have to move away from fossil fuels. We are on a path of insanity, and the science is so clear. The physics, it's just physics.
And I don't disagree with you, but I also know a lot of the machinery needs fossil fuels to be able to function and work too.
Yeah. Correct? I mean, so the complications are massive. Cement, steel, I mean, these things are just carbon intensive and they require a lot of energy. Until we develop systems to do these things, environmentally friendly, we're going to have issues. There are amazing things happening,
though. I love your film, and I love what we're talking about, because your films encompass what's going on in the world, not just with the ocean, but also how we have to make these choices coming. Yep. And our show is always outside the box. We always think outside the box. You guys are doing great stuff, and I know the films are going to make impacts, and I hope a lot of kids get to see the films.
I hope so.
Really good. You're both passionate about it, too. Let me ask you questions, because we are doing this right now. I'm guessing you guys want to do another documentary coming up, right?
Hopefully. Yep.
So how do you find your subject and how do you pick it? Does it come to you or do you go to it?
Both. There's been subjects that I've developed and went out and found the funding to do and go other places. This film, it was an offshoot of a film I did previously. They liked what I did and came and commissioned me to make this film, which I was very flattered and honored to have the opportunity to tell the story. And it was a wonderful challenge, you know, as well. So it's nice when those kinds of things happen. So, but I do have projects that I've been developing and I'm looking at a few of them to go back to, but some other people are talking to me about other films, you know, that they might like.
So what are you going to do your second film?
So for me, Alex? For me, it's going to, you know, this world of science storytelling is one that, as a researcher, I have a list of 603 scientists that I've done deep dive research into that, you know, I've planned out entire TV series of this.
And 603 scientists.
603.
You mean like your guy you're doing right now.
I mean, welcome.
Yeah, a real Indiana Jones.
I mean, some of them are more compelling than others, but
really? He's got 50 seasons ahead of him. So he's going to be a busy guy.
I am ready, and I'm just looking for people who care about this type of storytelling in a way that can support it and bring it to the masses. I want to create an ecosystem of creating scientific heroes.
That's really good.
And that's
you just gave me an idea. We'll have to talk about it.
That's really good.
Maybe we need to honor those scientists for the work they're doing in the environment.
Yeah, that's great idea.
Well, the interesting thing about it is I've been fortunate to build a career basically interpreting what scientists and engineers do for a general audience. And these are amazing people that aren't comfortable talking much about their, you know, the kinds of people we're talking about are really in their element when they go off by themselves to tops of mountains or, you know, yep, the bottom of the ocean or all these different kinds of things. And so there's a lot of people that are out there that are doing amazing things in amazing places that we don't know about. And yep, so the kinds of stories he's talking about are amazing, amazing things. So,
all right.
And hopefully, we can inspire more kids to, you know, get off their little screens and get into the real world, into the natural world, and start doing science and seeing how cool it is to be out and going to these amazing places and studying the kinds of things that are out there. So,
all right, it's the Blue Water Film Festival, starts next Thursday, and you're on the 21st, but your film's on, tell them what day, yours on the 22nd, tell the audience.
So the film Canary is showing at noon on the 22nd at the Ryford Public Library in La Jolla. And I think it's just followed immediately by
yours is right after 2 o'clock.
Same place.
At 2 o'clock.
Will you have popcorn?
That's a good question.
I don't know. It's a library. So I don't know.
That wasn't in the talking
points.
It's
a nice little room. It's a nice room. I think the capacity is 100 seats. Okay. So,
wow.
Yeah.
Nice.
So it'll be nice. Very nice. It's a very nice room. So.
Well, both of you did phenomenal work. The passion shows, the creativity, and thank you both for being here.
Yeah, you want to make a closing statement before we leave? We make a closing statement, and you make one. What do you want to tell the world?
I mean, the number one thing is believe in yourself and your dreams, because, you know, I changed my career 180 degrees and went after something. I took inspiration from Lonnie's story in Canary to know that you can accomplish things that are very hard. So just cool. Believe in yourself and have a goal.
Right.
Well, that's a hard one to follow. but I just hope people will come out and see these stories. You know, it's hard to get, as I was mentioning, it's hard to get people to come out and from beyond just the core audience of environmental, the audience for environmental and nature films. But they really are important. And if you do care about things like fishing, or you care about hunting, or, you know, some of the original conservationists were hunters and fishermen, you know, Trout Unlimited, Ducks Unlimited, you know, these people care about maintaining habitat out there. Maybe they don't have the same philosophy as, you know, the Sierra Club or the National Wildlife Federation or something like that, but at least they're on the same side of trying to, you know, preserve habitat and natural places. And so, I hope that, you know, maybe that's the first place we can start to build bridges is between conservationists. You know, the Ducks Unlimited and the hunters and fishermen are considered to be conservationists, and the tree huggers are considered to be environmentalists. So if we can get conservationists and tree huggers on the same side of things and be listening to each other and helping each other preserve, you know, nature, it'll be a good start. So.
Well, what we like to bring to our audience on the Brett and Larry podcast show is inspirational, passionate people, passionate stories. And we had two great ones today. Thanks, Lindsey. And thank you, Alex, very, very much.
Thank you both.
Tell everyone goodbye, Brett.
Everybody take care and be nice to each other.
Bye, everyone.